Hello and welcome once more to Conscious TV. I'm Iain McNay and my guest today is Scilla Elworthy. Hi Scilla.
Hello.
And Scilla was very highly recommended from somebody we had on a few months ago called Andrew Harvey. He said, you've got to get Scilla. And I had to pursue Scilla a bit because it wasn't easy to start with, but she's here with us now. We're very pleased to have her as a guest. And she's written some books. I only have one copy here of one of them. It's Making Terrorism History, which we'll cover in the interview, but it's much wider than that. It's really about her life, the inner side of her life and the outer side. She's done many interesting things, and we're going to find out what makes Scilla tick, if you like, and also what she's done outside in the world. She's been nominated for the Nobel Peace Prize 3 times. So, you were born into a military family. So how was that as a child? Were things very organised?
I think it was brisk, to say the least. My father was a very elderly father. He was 55 when I was born, and he ruled our family with a rod of iron. I had 4 older brothers, and so I learned to be a pretty good hooker in a rugby team.
Really?
And learned to shoot quite early on and things like that. We were living on a farm. It was very, very rural, very hands-on, very earthbound, and I loved it.
And then your brother was killed, wasn't he, when you were quite young in a car accident? Yeah. That really affected you.
Yeah, it was. It was most frightening because the family didn't grieve. My mother and father were so overcome with emotion that they didn't know how to handle, that they really closed up the house, drew the shutters. We lived in the dark for a week.
Wow.
And I was completely bewildered, just with loss, and without it being mentioned.
And how old were you at the time?
10.
That is a big shock at 10. It's just not recognised at all. But I guess, is that the military way of dealing with things? Because if you're in the military, you're faced with death a lot, usually.
Yes, it could be, and also I think our parents, my parents' generation, my father was born in 1889, were not brought up to be what we would call emotionally intelligent. Mm. I think that wasn't part of, they would have thought that was, you know, too wishy-washy. So I had to grow out of that attitude, I think.
But how did it affect you inside at the time, do you think?
Ooh, it was like a blow at the heart, you know. It took me years and years to work it out. Mm. Terrible feeling of loss, because he was the most loving one of the family, really, and I depended on him.
And then you, at 13, you talk in your book about you were watching the TV, and it was, well, I remember it well, 1956, when the Russian tanks were rolling into Budapest and people were getting killed, and there was a lot of protests from young people.
Well, kids my age, I was 13, were throwing themselves at the tanks, and I rushed upstairs and started packing my suitcase, and my mother came up and said, "What are you doing?" And I said, "I'm going to Budapest," without really knowing where Budapest was. And she said, "Don't be so silly. What for?" And I said, "Well, there's something terrible happening there and I have to go." And she said, "Pull yourself together." And then I began to cry, and then she saw how important it was for me. And bless her, she said, "Now look, you can't be any use at your age, but if you get trained, you might be some use. So I'll see to it that you get some training if you just unpack your suitcase." So I did. And she did.
You see, she listened to you, didn't she?
She did. She did.
And my guess is that was fundamental, because from what I understand, you're a good listener as well, and that's, you kind of learned early on how important it is that parents listen to their children.
Absolutely. She was a great mother. My father died when I was 18 and my mother died when I was 30. So I lost them both quite young. But she left a huge impact on me. She was a very compassionate woman, a sort of tough compassion, if you know what I mean.
It's interesting, this whole thing of listening. We were talking earlier about Joe Berry and Pat McGee, and that we did a program with them on Conscious TV a few weeks ago. And just very briefly, Joe Berry, her father, was killed in the Brighton bombing. Sir Anthony Berry, he was killed in that. And she really wanted to know why somebody would kill her father. So when he was out from jail, the person, Pat McGee, who planted the bomb, she wanted to meet with him. And she was saying in the interview that when they sat down together the first time, which I know you helped to some extent to arrange, in early 2000, they had a three-hour meeting, and what Pat McGee was so surprised about was Joe was interested in listening to him. Mm. And okay, she was the victim in a way. Her father had been killed by his bomb, but she was willing to listen for an hour and a half to why he did that. And it's interesting. And he said at that point in the interview, he said that after an hour and a half, he didn't know who he was anymore, because this had never happened to him. Mm. And it's so simple, yet it's so important to listen to the other.
Yes, and Joe did a fabulous job there. I didn't help to set up the meeting. I simply supported Joe.
Okay, yeah.
And then I brought them both, soon after their first meeting, to appear live on the Barbican stage when we did a day's seminar on trauma, actually. And
right.
That was back in 2002, I think.
Yeah. So what's gone wrong with people not wanting to listen, or not being able to listen, or not knowing how to listen? What's happened, do you think, in society? Because we've become a society of talkers rather than listeners.
I think it's ego. I think one of the features of our present-day society is that ego has gone rampant. Everything is to do with what I need and what I want. And I think that's been a progression. Certainly Eckhart Tolle would say that it's the main ill of our day, and therefore everything that we can do to observe our ego, to become the watcher of the ego, to gradually allow it to be not who we really are, but to become the present watcher. And that is going to be the way past this ego obsession, because if your ego is very hungry, you want everybody to listen to you, and you don't want to listen to them. And yet, as you know so well, because you listen to people all day, the secret of unraveling the cycle of violence, for example, one of the secrets of that is listening.
Mm. So what you're saying, which is interesting, I hadn't thought it this way before, you can't really listen to someone else until you're willing to listen to your own ego and watch it and realize actually you're separate from that ego chattering away, talking about the past and the present and the might not. But that, of course, is not who we really are.
Exactly. And it's only when we begin to observe it and smile a little bit at its antics and how grabby it is, and how judgmental. You know, you can be with a group of people and you're making little judgments about them in your head all the time. And once you can notice it, what's going on, that's at least three quarters of the way to freedom.
Mm.
I haven't got there.
Well,
I haven't got there.
But at least you're talking about it.
I'm passionately interested in it.
Yeah. Well, we'll follow sequentially your story a little bit, and then we can come back. This is a very interesting subject. And your story kind of explains a lot why you've just said what you said, because at 16, you went to a Sue Ryder home for people who'd been in camps for displaced persons.
Yeah, that's
since
what my mum
war.
Fixed up. Mm.
Right. And you were actually with people who'd been in concentration camps, and you listened to their stories.
I did. I was sitting peeling potatoes. This was in Suffolk, and people were there on holiday from their camps. And there was an old man who sat and talked to me while I was peeling potatoes. I'll never forget it. And he showed me the mark of a boot on his neck And he told me about how his face had been smashed in the snow by this guy's boot. And I couldn't believe that humans could do that to humans. And I was glued to the whole thing of concentration camps for the next 5 years. I read everything I could, I watched all the pictures, everything.
Mm. But at 16, that's quite horrifying, isn't it, to hear these stories?
Blah.
So what did it do for you in terms of emotions and feelings?
Well, I think it touched that very hurt part of me, loss, part of loss. But at the same time, it was a fuel. I was angry, and I'm very sure that anger, if you spray anger out at the people you're angry with, and it's like gasoline, and somebody lights a match, it's an inferno. Mm. But if you use anger or grief or horror as a fuel, it's like you can put it in your engine and it will propel you forward and give you the energy to do the kind of work that needs doing.
Mm. It does seem from an early age you had this engine that was kind of pushing you forward in terms of exploration and finding out more.
Yeah, curious. I was always curious.
Yeah.
But I made some substantial detours along the way.
Well, I think that's nothing wrong with that. That's kind of how we really learn, isn't it, to do a few detours. And then you went to a camp for Vietnamese refugees in France. So something was drawing you to hear the stories of people that were really had been through really difficult times.
Well, that was in my university vacation, and I had chosen to do a dissertation on refugees. And so going to listen to people who'd recently been evacuated from Vietnam really helped a lot. And after that, I went from there to Algiers, and it was just at the end of the Algerian war. Most brutal war. And there were a lot of orphans who'd lost both parents, and there was a home for them, and I went and worked in that home. And that was another eye-opener, just into the unspeakable tragedy of people's lives wrecked by violence.
Do you think part of this was possibly connected with not grieving for your brother?
Could be. Looking back, it could have been. But also, I think my mother always... one of the big words in her vocabulary was useful, to be useful. Mm. And there's a poem by Marge Piercy that I found in later life called To Be of Use that I love. And it's something to do with... It was really what I wanted to do with my life, was to be useful. And I think I'm lucky to have that kind of... It's not a calling exactly, it's more a push than a calling.
Mm. And I guess it's still driving you now. We'll come on to that later, but I guess it's still driving you now, yeah. And then, yeah, you were in South Africa, and again you were drawn to work with people that were in pretty poor social situations, and I know you helped them out practically.
Well, when I first arrived in South Africa, I didn't, because the only thing I was trained for was social work, and I thought if I go and do social work in South Africa, I'll be in jail in 5 minutes. So I went completely the opposite direction. I went into retail fashion, and I ended up running a chain of shops and introducing the Mary Quant, if you remember Mary Quant.
Of course I do, yeah.
Introducing the Mary Quant range into South Africa. And I did a lot of modelling and all that sort of stuff, and it was very glitzy. And I completely closed my eyes to everything that was going on in the country.
Mm.
And lived like that for 3 years, earning a fortune, aged 23. And it was only when I got married and went to university and actually studied Zulu and began to be able to talk to people that I began to find out what was really going on in the country.
Yeah, it's interesting though, you somehow you're in another situation with people that are going through a very difficult time.
Yeah. Well, the organisation that I worked for was called Kupugani, which means pull yourself up by your bootstraps, self-help, if you like.
Mm.
And it was exposing situations of real starvation in the country, although the government claimed there was no starvation. And So we were dealing with children with great bellies from Kwashiorkor dying of starvation, while next to them white people were pouring milk down the mines. And so what we did was to get hold of that milk and get it made into milk powder and get it to the young children. So it was diverting food surpluses to people who were desperately in need.
And then you got very ill, didn't you?
Well, just after my daughter was born in 1974, 6 weeks later I got a disease called encephalitis. And I was in a coma for a couple of weeks.
This is the inflammation of the brain, is that
right? It's the inflammation of the fluid surrounding the brain and that goes down the spinal cord. And when I woke up from this coma, I was just subject to blinding headaches for about 6 years. And it was a long, long recovery. And the specialist, when we went to the specialist, he did a encephalogram or whatever they call it, and when the results came through he said, well, you have to tell you, you've lost a third of your brain cells and they're not regenerative. And I burst into tears. And he said, what are you crying for? You've got a nice husband and a pretty face, you'll be fine. I nearly, if I'd known what I know now, I probably would have hit him.
Well,
that's all he knew.
So but that was an important catalyst, wasn't it? Because through that, when you eventually did, it was acupuncture, I think, that helped you to come out of that. And then you started to look more deeply inside and ask some more fundamental questions.
Well, there really was only one thing going round and round in my head for those 6 years of recovery, which was one question, who am I? And in those days, that wasn't a very frequently asked question. Nobody knew what I was talking about. Well, you know, you're who you are. So it took a long time before I found my way to a Jungian psychoanalyst in Paris. We lived in Paris then. And I'm infinitely grateful to what Jung discovered, because I learned to piece together symbols and dreams and legends and myths and understand life more from that perspective. And that was fascinating.
So on a personal level, give me some insight into how you saw your own life more clearly.
Well, it was still pretty much a muddle. I think what happened is I began to look inside and sort of self-inspect and wanting to know how I ticked. And so I would sort of start to look at my motivations for things that I said and did, and I also became very conscious of a hugely active inner critic that I have, that I think a lot of people have. But for many of us, it's just a kind of nasty voice that sits on our shoulder like a parrot. And
so we're judging ourselves.
Yes, exactly.
It's also called the superego, isn't it, I think?
Yes, yeah. quite vicious it can be. And I had a particularly virulent one of those. And so rather than it destroyed me from time to time. You know, I got very depressed from time to time. But I began to realize that I could observe it. And once you observe what it's doing, you can then be a little bit more objective. And then that's the path to freedom.
Because from what I know about the inner critic is that it's very much connected to can be usually very much connected to the voices of your parents. So they would be critical for whatever reason, probably because their parents were critical to them, and you're kind of perpetuating this thing that comes down the generations.
Exactly. So the more we can do to deal with it, to address it, we're stopping a generational pattern.
Yes. And of course that was the beginning of what you were saying earlier in the program about how you were watching and seeing that you weren't the ego. And to start with, you see you're not actually what I would call the superego. You call it the inner critic, it's the same thing.
Yes, exactly. And also in rare moments, beginning to contact whatever is more the real part of us. The soul, if you like, And I began to draw a lot of pictures then and make pictures of what my soul felt like and so on.
Yeah. Mm. I think when you go on that journey, and I've been on this journey for a long time now, it's a little bit scary at times, but it's also very exciting because it's like discovering a whole new magical world inside yourself that you kind of didn't know existed. Well, you kind of knew it was there, but it was a little bit like the hidden garden, and you open the door and there's a whole, not only is it a beautiful garden, but there's wild things in there as well. And
it's overgrown, there's monsters.
It's certainly overgrown because it's neglected. And you start looking in there and you find incredible things.
Some things jump out of the undergrowth at you.
Yes, mm-hmm. Yeah. But a lot of the time there's a logic to it. You can understand it. You can get to the reason why you and me are the way we are.
Exactly. And there's a great beauty, as you hinted. There's a great beauty there.
Mm. So, and then I think you also got into meditation.
Mm-hmm. Around that time, it was pretty much when I started to work with the Oxford Research Group, because I did a study for UNESCO, which made me begin to write about women's role in bringing about peace research and so forth. And while I was doing this study, I met a lot of very remarkable, powerful women who were active in this world of peace and disarmament. And so I found myself in New York at the United Nations for their 6-week conference on nuclear disarmament. And nothing was happening in this conference. And then there was a massive demonstration. 1 million people came to Central Park. And next day, the New York Times gave it 5 pages, but nothing changed at the UN. Nothing changed. Mm. And I was strap hanging on a tram on Broadway, and I thought, is there something wrong here? You know, you can't have more than 1 million people. And suddenly I thought, if all these people demonstrating in the street who care so much could talk calmly one-to-one and listen to those who are making the decisions on nuclear weapons, then things might change. So I chucked up what I was doing in New York, came home, and used my savings to set up a research group round my kitchen table. And that's what became this slowly developing set of dialogues with people who design nuclear warheads, who strategize with them, who make money out of them, people who write the checks for them, and the politicians who eventually distribute them. And I got to know a lot of these people as human beings. And although I was horrified by what they do, I was able to listen to them as humans. And that meant that we could gradually create a space strong enough to invite them into it to meet their informed critics. So we would have, say, the head of nuclear warhead development from Los Alamos meeting his counterpart from Russia or China, plus somebody who had perhaps been at Aldermaston but had decided to do something better and could really talk to them about how to get out of this mess that we were in. And that really taught me about the value of meditation, because of what we did. We called it the standing stones. I realized that meditation is so powerful that if there are people meditating in a room, something shifts in the atmosphere. So I asked 5 people, mainly Quakers that I knew, because I was a Quaker by then, if they would sit in the library underneath the meeting room where these discussions took place and meditate all day. And they agreed. It was a 2-day meeting. And it had an extraordinary effect. On the second day of one of the meetings, a man from the State Department came to me and he said, "Scilla, this is a very special room. we're meeting in, and I said, no, it was built in 1360. It was a wonderful old manor house. And he said, no, it's a very special room. And I said, yes, I mean, people have been doing yoga in here and meditating for some time. And he said, oh, no, there's something coming up through the floorboards. Mm. So I told him, and he said, you're kidding. And I said, no, you ask those people who serve you your lunch, it's them. Mm. And he was just amazed. But it worked so well that we now do it always when we have meetings.
You have people meditating underneath?
Well, if we can, or in a room adjacent.
Yeah, isn't that interesting, yeah. Mm. I know we had John Hagelin at one time on Conscious TV, mm-hmm. who's a great practitioner of TM, and he was telling various stories about if you get enough people to meditate in a certain area where there's conflict, that can help reduce or even eliminate the conflict and even crime as well. So
it can.
Yeah. Mm. I know that NASA had also done research into meditation and how effective, and also prayer, mm. how that can also be very effective.
It can.
Yeah, it's so simple, yet it's... We forget the simple things in life, don't we, sometimes?
We do. And I think it's all about becoming aware of the field, what they call the conscious field. Mm. In other words, that there is an atmosphere created by people being very focused that you can't really quantify, but once you start to become aware of it, you know it's there and you can work with it. It can inform mm-hmm. you, actually. It's got higher intelligence than anything that's in here.
Yeah, that's a tough one for so many people to think that something like a field that is intangible to them, they can't see it, can actually be smarter than the knowledge that we learn and we accumulate through life.
Yeah, people think it's pretty wacky, but I know it works.
Yeah, yeah. So, and I know also from reading your book that taking sabbaticals are very important to you, and you sometimes you get, I don't know if it still happens, but it's certainly, you've been through these times where you just burn out, and it's kind of, you realise you just got to rest, and you rest for 2 or 3 months, and then you slowly come back into things again.
Mm. Yes. I'm a bit of a slave driver, and I think it was partly my my colleagues who wanted me to take a sabbatical, because I used to push people very hard. Because I was always in a rush, impatient. It's one of my worst characteristics is impatience. And very driven. Not so much now, but certainly was. So I think they often encouraged me to go for a sabbatical. And just be in my garden. I love gardening. I get my feet and my hands in the earth and I'm happy. And a bit more grounded, I think. And so, yes, I used to, from time to time, still do, take 2 or 3 months off and think and walk a lot. I walked once from north of Delhi over the Himalayas, and that was the biggest spiritual experience of my life, doing that.
Wow.
Yeah, it was fantastic.
How long did that take?
24 days.
And you were camping out?
Yeah.
Huh. Must be wonderful just waking up. Yeah, I guess you were in a tent, weren't you, at night? Were you in tents? Yeah,
tent.
Waking up in the morning and you see the mist clearing in the mountains.
Amazing. It was absolutely amazing.
Mm. Yeah. So what were the factors that helped you in this change from being this driven person to a bit more relaxed about life? Is it life experiences that you've had, or is it doing the meditation? Is it just getting older? Or?
I think it's partly to do with becoming a bit more friendly to oneself. There's a lovely little verse that means a lot to me. I think it's by, I can't remember the name of the poet, and it's very short. It says, and so did you get what you wanted from life, even so? And the response is, I did. And what did you want? And the response is, to know myself beloved, to call myself beloved on this earth. And I think that's a beautiful way of saying that one of the main things for a human being in our world to learn is affection for the self, acceptance of the self. And it's a counterbalance to the incessant demands of the ego. Because the ego is a bottomless pit of need and want and making other people wrong and being right and all that. And the more we can love what is here and accept what is here, the calmer we can be, I suppose.
So when you say what is here, what do you mean by that? Because we've already established from what you said that you can watch the ego. So if you watch the ego and you're not the inner critic and all those programs and histories, then what do you find?
I suppose just the sort of I am, the consciousness. And once you try and grab it, it's gone. So it's fleeting, but it's like being at home. It's like total peace, and affection, just as affection for a baby can calm it from crying, you know, to be really held. If one can do the same for oneself, everything kind of, you know, not so demanding.
Yeah, it's unfortunately, in a way, society is going a different direction. That's not entirely true, but generally. And we still seem to be so driven for outward success and the material and being a somebody, when actually, as you've discovered, being a somebody actually isn't it at all.
Well, yeah, and I've been the worst of those, you know. I realised about 2 years ago that I minded so much about my reputation, you know, what it was sort of this archetype. Do you know who I am? You know, it's ridiculous. But you take yourself so seriously that you're like heavy, you know, you're very dense. And so I decided I want to try and become lighter as I get older, and not take myself so seriously. But we mind so much what other people think, and it is very, very strong.
Yeah.
In our culture, and we're encouraged in that direction all the time by advertising. You need to have these holidays, you need to have these clothes, you need to have this Botox and facelifts, and you don't look right as you get older and all that.
It's all a fake, because it doesn't matter what you have on the outside, you're never going to find it.
That's right.
But the trouble is, you have to go part of the way down the path to realise that, and that's the shame of the whole thing, yeah. I want to spend a little time talking about, it's only a small book, this Making Terrorism History, but I thought there were some really interesting things in there, and it's interesting, we've just done a programme about trauma with some other guests, and one of the things the point you make here is actually with terrorism, it's not actually, for the terrorists, it's not necessarily a specific enemy on the outside. A lot of it comes from their own personal situation. Often they've been through terrible trauma. In a way, they've been terrorized. Mm-hmm. They've lost their home and their family, or what they feel is their family. And they're in a situation somehow they're getting angry and they want to fight back. And it isn't so much that they want something, it's what they don't want. Mm-hmm. So just tell us a little bit more about that in terms of how you see that.
Well, I see it almost as a cycle of violence, that you have some atrocity, whether it was personal or in the family, something very harsh that happens. And that sets off a chain of events. The first reaction is terror as a result of the atrocity. Following on from terror is a lower level of fear, but that leads to grief. And grief then leads to anger. So as you come out of grief, you really feel angry about this thing that happened. And if nothing is done at that stage, the anger hardens into bitterness, And bitterness hardens into the wish for retaliation and then revenge.
Yeah.
And then you commit the same atrocity that was done to you. Mm. And this seems to be applicable whether it's in a family or a community or in Pakistan with the Taliban. And so what I've been interested in is what methodologies work to interrupt that cycle of violence.
Which, as you were saying, you need to do at the anger cycle.
Or before. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because otherwise, it's interesting, it's like a circle that completes itself.
Yeah.
So unless something is changed, it's self-perpetuating.
Mm.
Yeah.
And you can trace it, you know, in the history of all these conflicts.
So what can be done then in terms of intervention?
Well, there's all sorts of different levels of things that can be done. if you work at the political level, for example, one of the things you must do in a conflict-ridden place is to separate the combatants. So you need to send in the United Nations peacekeeping troops, something to stop the shooting. That's the first thing. And so then gradually you can progress as you get, you know, ceasefire and so forth. You can then begin to work at the political level to make a fairer to bring in the rule of law, for example, to bring in a judicial system, voting, free elections, free press, and so on. Then if you think about the physical level, people, whether it's in a family or whatever, they need to be safe from violence. So some quarantine needs to be put around the violent person. They often, you know, need to be secluded, sometimes medicated, but it is very important that the violence in the family stops to allow those who are in the victim mode to recover their sense of self and be able to respond in a way that doesn't perpetuate the situation. And so at the physical level, there are many things you can do. One is to provide safe havens, to provide, as in the case of Syria now, camps that refugees can run to. In the case of children, there are many ways that are skillfully done now in this country to make children safer. But it's that physical safety. And then the other level is emotional, because people, as the guests you were talking to earlier, who have been severely traumatized, they do need to recover. And one of the greatest way that they can recover is to be listened to deeply. And that's a great skill, to really listen to somebody who suffered without trying to make it better, just to let them talk. Often, physical treatment is very good for psychological hurt. For example, like massage or acupuncture is very, very helpful. And there are many skilled ways now of helping with trauma, and sense of counselling and co-counselling even. And then one would look at the spiritual ways of interrupting the cycle of violence. And there I would mean things like, I've got loads of examples in each of these cases, but one that springs to mind is a young teacher in Germany, Thomas Hubel, who was deeply concerned about the unresolved trauma still in the German psyche after Second World War. And so he asked people to gather at Hitler's bunker, and hundreds of people came, and he had them meditate together for several hours and then to hum together. He calls it toning. And the humming becomes a kind of swirling sound, beautiful, like a flock of birds. And all these voices kind of going together. And it was so powerful that some of the people said to him, can we go to Israel and meet people who had been in the camps? And because his wife is Israeli, they did that. And I happened to be there. And I was present when some of these Germans, whose parents had probably been Nazis, met with Israelis whose parents had been in the camps. And they talked and listened one-to-one for an hour and or more. And tears were just streaming down both their faces. And it was that deep listening that changed things. Same in the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in South Africa. What was happening there was not so much at a political level, not even at an emotional level so much as at a spiritual level. Mm. I witnessed it, and you can feel it in your body.
Mm. It's interesting because Renata and I, we watched recently, there was a documentary made. You remember the film Schindler's List?
Mm.
There was, he had a daughter. The guy that was the head of the Nazi camp, mm-hmm. he had a daughter. And she met the girl who was kept in the basement. So she was the daughter of a Nazi perpetrator. And she met in a, they met in Germany at the campsite together. So it was the daughter of the Nazi met together with the girl that he kept in the basement.
Mm-hmm.
And of course that was in a very emotional mm-hmm. time. And again, it was about the ability to listen, and the ability mm-hmm. to listen wasn't quite manifest as much as it could have been, but you felt it was the start of something. And it is this thing that, in a way, we all come from the same source. We're all a unique expression of oneness. Mm-hmm. And what is conflict? Conflict is misunderstanding, trauma, ego out of control, whatever. But it comes down to, if we really look, and when we were talking to earlier today to Camilla Carr and John James, who were held hostage in Chechnya. There was a very moving thing they talked about, where the last few months here in hostage, they were with a very high Russian, mm-hmm. who was a personal envoy of Yeltsin, and he was kept with them. And their captor was a Chechnyan who obviously hated the Russians, and then the Chechnyan and the Russian started to realize, actually, well, they've got some things in common, and they would play chess together. And neither of them wanted to win. Mm. They didn't want to humiliate the other. And it's this, I always find it very touching, mm. these meetings that take place, obvious enemies. When they really meet, mm. they really listen, what they
exactly?
discover they're not enemies anymore.
Exactly. And it is an extraordinary power that this has. Once in Cape Town with my daughter, we went and sat in on the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. And young black man was under investigation there. And he'd been part of the African National Congress, and then he was turned by the security forces and he became an informer. And he caused the deaths of six of his former colleagues. They were shot in cold blood. And so here he was being examined with the families of the dead men sitting there. And it went on for about two or three days. And at the end of it, he was asked, what would you like to say? And he said, quite matter-of-factly, he said, well, I regret it. And one very clever commissioner said to him, is there anything else you'd like to say? And he sat and he thought for some time. And then he said, yes. He said, I'm prepared to go into a room with the mothers of each of the men that I killed and hear what they have to say to me. And I still get it now. The whole room got a shiver.
Yeah.
And that was the shift. That was transformation
yeah.
of that conflict.
Yeah.
Because everything changed.
Mm.
And so these processes are electrifyingly powerful.
Mm. And somehow, the more I look, the more it connects in. The human beings, they lose their barriers, they start to really connect.
Mm.
And in the same way that you noticed you could see that your ego mm. wasn't who you are, mm. really are. It's kind of, again, it's a kind of a dropping of barriers, a dropping of false separation.
Exactly.
So we have about 5 minutes left, mm-hmm. and I wanted to reserve that time to talk about what you're doing now. You have an initiative. I've got it wrong here, so you told me. So what actually is your initiative?
Well, I'd like to just mention Peace Direct, because that's okay. my real baby.
Yeah.
I started Peace Direct in 2002. And what Peace Direct does is to identify and support people who are brave enough in areas of hot conflict to risk their lives so that other people don't get killed. So these are natural, local peace builders, and they do the most courageous work I've ever come across. They're my heroes. So that work continues, and it's constantly inspiring on all these levels we've talked about. And that's how I get to meet these remarkable people. The initiative that is just brewing now is to set up an Institute for Transformational Futures at the University of Falmouth in Cornwall. And the point of that is to teach courses. The first one will actually be this summer, for young social entrepreneurs, to teach them the inner skills, the inner intelligence, if you like, that they need, everything we've been talking about, that they need in order to be able to be far more effective in the work that they're doing in the world. Because very often, as myself, when we're very driven by anger or outrage, we can tend to make situations worse by trying to do good or trying to interfere. And you require a level of self-knowledge to be able to do it more cleanly, if you like. And so that's what we're offering. And we're going to do a lot of research on all these things we've been talking about. And I feel it's the cutting edge. Business people are very interested in it now, and I run courses for what we call awakened leadership amongst top business leaders, who are waking up very quickly to the realization that to have a good atmosphere, in a good communication in their companies, and more aware people, things just start to flow in a way that they don't when there's a lot of conflict.
Yes, and I think the new way of doing business is actually to have less, ironically, less competition within the business. It doesn't mean to say you have no competition, but you're not got divisions fighting each other. You've got them working together for the whole. Mm. Again, it's that thing again of not having always the separation, but looking at the bigger picture and seeing what we can do the whole, because it's the whole we come from anyway.
Exactly. Yeah.
Trying to find our way back.
Yeah.
So we need to finish now, Scilla. I very much appreciate you coming in to Conscious TV. And good luck with your projects.
Thank you. I've enjoyed it.
As always. And thank you, everyone, for watching Conscious TV. And I hope we see you again soon. Goodbye.